short videos. Thank you all for coming to listen to what's an interesting but also sadly very depressing topic. So I wanted to just show three very short videos to give you an introduction both in terms of the Syrian crisis but also the larger context in which this crisis is unfolding. And then the last video really on root causes of forcible displacement. And then that relates directly to the work that we're doing in the International Human Rights Clinic at the law school. So let me just start with this one.
They flee in crushing numbers, driven by war, by ethnic conflict, by natural disasters, by fear. Today, the number of the uprooted is staggering. 59.5 million forcibly displaced in
2014.
The numbers explode upwards. 13.9 million newly displaced people, 11 million within their own country. That's the highest figure on record. In 2010, 10,900 people fled every day. 2013, that had tripled to 32,200. In 2014, it rose again dramatically to 42,500. A small city fleeing every day. In 2014, one person of every 122 in the world was forcibly displaced.
We no longer have the capacity to pick up the pieces. More and more people are suffering, and more of the people that are suffering have no chance to get protection or support because we no longer have the resources to do so.
Syria, Afghanistan, Somalia. Half the world's refugees are from these three countries. Conflict drives them out. Long savage wars condemn them to bitter exile. Syria's neighbor, Turkey, became in 2014 the world's largest refugee hosting country, with no fewer than 1.59 million people. It was followed by Pakistan, Lebanon, Iran, Ethiopia, and Jordan. Alongside the refugees, those forced from their homes, but not their countries. 2014 saw new conflict, new wounds, and tens of thousands of the newly internally displaced in Iraq, in Cameroon, Ukraine, Central African Republic, South Sudan. In 2014, there were 38.2 million, an increase of almost 5 million over 2013. Conflicts, new and old, but one brutal constant: the young bear the brunt of suffering. More than 50% of the world's refugees are under the age of 18. In northern Iraq, a small boy cries. He is Yazidi, driven with his family from his home. He is internally displaced. The system set up decades ago to help these people is at a tipping point. The world cannot turn away. We cannot simply do what we have done in the past. We must do more, much more, to overcome a crushing crisis.
Sorry.
It might be because it's linked to the first few words that says the world in crisis, 2015.
Oh, it could be.
Really.
Where's that?
So if we just copy.
Oh, yes, I see what I did. Yeah, I can't stick up to it.
And then now it has a colon
there. Yes. There you go. This is bringing the information up to the current time.
Asylums and internally displaced. Almost double the number 10 years ago. It's a rising tide spilling across borders. Fifteen conflicts, either new or burning again, in the last 5 years. 42,500 people displaced each day, every day. Mega conflicts in Syria and Iraq have displaced 15 million people, conflict pushing refugees and migrants into flight. Protracted exile, lives of extreme poverty, hopelessness driving thousands to risk their lives. Mediterranean deaths in 2015, almost 3,000, and climbing. The wave is now global. Drive to find safety has overwhelmed some countries, stretched the resources of others, but also awakened generosity. Across the globe, countries that have taken in so many need much more help now. Another pressing need, protect people against populist racism and xenophobia. But most of all, these people need more hope. UNHCR was born of the search for new values in the wake of a global war, its principles enshrined in the 1951 Convention. Those pillars must now be safeguarded and strengthened.
So what I think I'll do is hold on to the last one, and we'll talk a little bit, and then I can show you that one at the end if we have time. I think this gives you a pretty good picture of sort of the world in crisis and how forcible displacement affects issues not in a particular area of the world, but that they spill over and are interconnected and affect all of us. So before talking a bit more about the Syrian crisis in particular and our work there, I want to tell you a little bit about what the BU Law School International Human Rights Clinic does. So we do research, we conduct field work, and we report and map on international problems related to forced migration, particularly refugees. We look for legal solutions to major issues involving human rights of refugees and the forcibly displaced. And we advocate for and on behalf of partner organizations around the world, our clients, in international and regional human rights machinery on cases and issues concerning refugees. We also co-counsel and we litigate human rights cases. And I'm always amazed when I talk to in my introductory international human rights seminar that most of my students have never heard of the regional human rights machinery that we have here in the Americas, the Inter-American Commission, the Inter-American Court, and the Organization of American States. We actually do exist within a region that has a very robust human rights machinery that most Americans have never heard of. So that's part of my job.
Has Donald Trump heard of it?
Sorry?
Has Donald Trump heard of it?
I don't think so. I don't think he's heard of human rights. Anyway, editorial comment aside, in the last few years, our focus has been on protracted refugee situations, and we've been looking at the comparison and looking at legal solutions for particularly three of the major protracted refugee situations, which is the Palestinians, the Tibetans, and the Sahrawi refugees. So our work on the Syrian crisis, let me start a little bit with something of the scope of the refugee problem, and I looked at the most recent figures given by UNHCR, the international organization that's responsible for protection of the majority of the world's refugees. And as of November of 2015, UNHCR figures show 4.7 million total persons from Syria registered as refugees with the agency in the region. And it, a combination of 2.1 million registered in Egypt, Iraq, Jordan, and Lebanon, and 2 million registered in Turkey alone. There are also about 30,000 Syrian refugees registered in North Africa, and this is double the number that it was last year at the same time. So our aim with our work, and we did a, we undertook a two-year mapping project in the main host countries for the Syrian refugees, and that was Egypt, Turkey, Lebanon, and Jordan. And our mapping was to look at the interplay of laws and policies at the domestic and regional level affecting the refugees in these four states, and then addressing the key protection gaps between existing legal obligations and implementation on the ground. Our second aim was to link these findings to international obligations of responsibility sharing, and then to assess key mechanisms that require third states outside the region to offer refugee and humanitarian status to the refugees in their territories. We completed the report in the summer of 2014, and I'm going to update a few of the basic figures, but there have been other changes in the policies in the region since we completed our report, including, most importantly, the basically open door policies that the host states had initially had towards the Syrian refugees has now become a closed door policy towards new Syrian entrants over the last approximately year and a half. There's some reasons for this. We'll touch on a couple of them. What we learned was that the main host countries to the Syrians fleeing the civil wars was that they had no applicable refugee and asylum frameworks in place. before 2011. Lebanon and Jordan are not parties to the main international treaty governing the rights of refugees, which is the 1951 Refugee Convention, and its companion 1967 Protocol. And though Egypt and Turkey are parties to the convention, they've carved out significant exceptions to its application that have affected the status of Syrians as refugees. So as a result, all these states have been treating Syrians as irregular migrants or short-term visitors or guests, with policies that have fluctuated over time and in response to political whim, and also in response to domestic backlash. From the beginning of the crisis, the governments did not conceive of the incoming Syrians as refugees per se. Instead, they were guests, migrants, displaced civilians, or most recently, as a result of a major change in law in Turkey, persons under a status called temporary protection, which I'm going to talk a bit more about. Now, this reflected not only the ongoing absence of applicable domestic refugee frameworks, but also a major assumption that was quickly proved false, which was that the conflict would end quickly and the Syrians would return home. Much more can be said about refugee policies or lack thereof in the region, but the most important conclusion of our work was identifying the relationship between policies in the region and policies in other regions of the world that affect the Syrian refugees. If you read the agency and regional response plans that are put forward every year and actually every 6 months, you'll note that they focus on money. Billions of dollars have already been spent on this crisis. As of last September, Turkey's government claimed it had spent 5.37 billion euros of its own money, which well exceeded the entire donation of the EU by then to the crisis. But these plans and these proposals all work on what we call a paradigm of containment to the refugee crisis to the region. Our goal was to push back against that paradigm and refocus a refugee advocacy dialogue on a shared protection program that identifies status mechanisms to allow refugees to move out of the region and lift the crisis from the Middle East to become a shared responsibility on a global level towards the refugees themselves. We identified legal obligations primarily in the European and American regions and in key third states to grant refugees and other displaced a combination of short and long-term status through immigration, humanitarian, temporary protection, subsidiary protection, and family reunification programs. And each of those could be unpacked and I could talk about each one for about an hour, but I won't do that since we don't have that time. But it's all in our report. So let me make a few main observations before coming to our conclusions and recommendations. 900,000 Syrian refugees have sought asylum in all of Europe to date between April 2011 and December 2015, and very few have been granted so far. Only about 10% of the Syrian refugees found safety in Europe. Canada's new government initially committed to accepting 25,000 Syrian refugees, but has now reduced that commitment to about 10,000 so far. The US president last fall committed to admitting 10,000 Syrian refugees, but has received so much pushback that so far less than 2,000 Syrian refugees have been admitted here in the United States. And neither country is likely to allow significantly more under current reception policies. Visas to Syrians from Europe and the US fell dramatically very soon after the start of the crisis, primarily as a result of the closing of embassies in Syria and more restrictions in other embassies in the region. Other restrictive policies in Europe and the Americas penalizing illegal border crossers and preventing access to refugee status are creating enormous barriers to Syrian asylum seekers. As a result of these barriers, 374 people have already died or gone missing just since the start of this year. And in 2015, the International Organization for Migration reported 3,770 deaths at sea as people are trying to leave the Middle East region and move farther to Europe. 2 children drown on average every day in the Mediterranean or Aegean trying to reach Europe. All actors have agreed that resettlement under current policies will not address more than a few thousand Syrian refugees in the Middle East region. For example, the US, which has a yearly quota of 70,000 resettlement slots, has not even met that quota over the last at least 5 years, probably longer, let alone any serious discussion of expanding that number to respond to the crisis. Though Egypt, Jordan, and Lebanon have insisted on resettlement as a condition of their allowing refugee processing to take place in their territories, they have grave concerns about being the states where large resettlement, out of which large resettlement actually takes place to the West, because it will make them a draw for more refugees to come to their territories. Now, all the non-governmental organizations that we met across the region expressed concern about the huge backlog of refugee applications from other pre-existing refugee populations in their territories before the Syrian crisis even began. Somalis, Sudanese, Eritreans, Ethiopians, Afghans, Iraqis, and Iranians, some of whom have been waiting for years after refugee registration for resettlement out of the region. One Egyptian NGO staff member said to us, "Our backlogged refugees have to make way for the flavor of the month, the Syrians. That's the way the process operates." And finally, we noted a major concern about Palestinians who have been trapped in a region that has opted out of the international refugee regime, who have no protection agency or access to any durable solution, and each wave of Palestinian refugee flow has exacerbated their unique protection gap. And if one thinks the status of Syrian refugees is a disaster, the Palestinians out of Syria are in even more dire strait without access to any status whatsoever. So taking these main issues into account, we drafted a set of recommendations for primarily a temporary protection plan in the region, modeled on something that is a major development, which is Turkey's 2014 law on international and temporary protection, which for a time was working surprisingly well until recent pressure from Europe caused Turkey to essentially close its borders to prevent more refugees from entering and moving from Turkey through to Europe. We proposed an extension of this plan that Turkey has put in place under its 2014 LFIP, the law I mentioned, for Lebanon, Jordan, and Egypt, grounded in 2 regional instruments called the Casablanca Protocol and the Arab Charter, which have provisions that allow for a temporary protection regime, but closely modeled on Turkey's temporary protection law and an EU directive that also established temporary protection back during the Balkan crisis. Temporary protection is nothing new on the global scale, it's nothing new on the regional scale. The temporary protection plan that we formulated would allow for basic rights to be afforded uniformly in each of the host states with the assistance of the aid that's been flowing into the region to make this feasible. But second, and just as important, we proposed a European regional protection plan, much like the one that the EU put in place, or much of Europe put in place after the Balkan crisis. A temporary protection program that would allow Syrians to enter on a 2-year renewable status hosted by refugee agencies and by Arab communities in each state to guarantee short-term integration while the crisis plays itself out. Again, we have precedent for this, not just in the Balkan crisis, but in other crises in the European region. Our third set of recommendations is expedited resettlement and expanded resettlement slots for backlogged non-Syrian refugees throughout the region. So our premise was that other refugees should not have to pay for the Syrian crisis either, and there's a way to provide protection to both groups, one short term and one long term, under existing laws. Fourth, a separate temporary protection plan for the Palestinians, which I've actually been researching and writing about for long before the Syrian crisis, coupled with 3 to 5 year statuses in key states in Latin America that have also paved the way for this kind of program after the Iraq War. So these are just some of the main points about our work. And following the publication of our report, we received a great deal of response and positive feedback, as it appeared to be the first report with concrete proposals for sharing the responsibility of the Syrian refugee crisis across the major regions of the world that could accept refugees while lifting the burden from the frontline states that have long since reached absorption capacity. Since our report was framed to build on existing legal obligations that relevant states had already accepted, we weren't creating any new law, there would be no need for major new proposals and plans that really have little chance of success in an already xenophobic climate. Any new debate is probably off the table. We launched a modest advocacy effort through publishing several versions of our report in various journals and outlets, and advancing our recommendations at the United Nations High Commissioner for Refugees annual executive committee meeting in Geneva. And we presented our report conclusions at various conferences around the country, and we've met with key staffers in Congress. However, the response on the congressional front has been worse than dismal, essentially that there's no appetite to promote Syrian or, frankly, any other refugee resettlement in any significant way to the United States at present. So our advocacy remains a work in progress. I'm happy to talk more about this. Maybe I can show you just the last video on root causes, and it gives you an idea of the interrelated and difficult nature of the problem.
Whatever happens next, they've breached the first country.
Never in 6.5 decades have so many displaced people needed help. A flood of those fleeing violent conflict or disasters, those trapped far from home, living half lives. Root causes.
In the working
war. Persecution. Natural hazards and disaster, impunity and lawlessness, climate change, food insecurity, urbanization,
statelessness.
The world at a crossroads. Political leadership is urgent. A combination of age-old causes, conflicts, persecution, magnified by new problems, worrying global trends, climate upheavals. The result, a multitude of displaced, moving inside their own countries and across continents. Millions of lives locked, twisted, shattered. Stateless, 10 million need citizenship. Disaster and climate displacement. 26 million need shelter and food security. Syrian refugees, 4.3 million new peace. Internally displaced, 38.2 million need a way home. Asylum seekers, 2.3 million need a decision. The needs are too many and resources too few. The real need, to address the root causes of displacement and to bring it to an end. The key, prevention, protection, solutions. How can we help people remain at home? How can we help get them back home? How can we help them if they cannot go home? The imperative, a renewal of political will, political leadership, a commitment to good governance, the rule of law, human rights, and the will link help to development. Old wounds, new dangerous trends, a world of people in need.
We don't know till now, once the train arrives, where will it end up? A lot of reports train being
So I think the last video really illustrates something that we try to tackle, which is the interrelated nature of these conflicts, and that you cannot focus on a single refugee population, especially in regions that have been housing refugees for decades. So right now, for example, Lebanon, 1 in 4 people in Lebanon is a refugee. You just imagine what that means for a population that itself has only recently emerged from a couple decades of civil war. So our aim is not just to look at sort of band-aid solutions and make proposals that deal with one issue at a time, but try to look in a more holistic manner at solutions built on law that can promote longer-term resolution of some of these problems, and that was a major impetus for this particular study. So I think I'll stop there and just let us have a little conversation.
And folks, sorry for the pizza situation. They dropped it off somewhere else and it disappeared and it's coming again, so.
It'll be here within hopefully
blame
10
auto.
Minutes.
So, thank you for the great summary of the what's going on and, you know, your wonderful research. I would definitely like to hear more as time goes on. I did want to hear more about, like, you know, earlier you mentioned how the previously open policies has now become the closed policies, and if you could say, you know, what's the difference?
Yeah. So at the beginning of the crisis and really until the middle of 2014 or towards the end of 2014, all of the host governments were basically permitting Syrians to come in, giving them a kind of short-term, various kinds of short-term statuses that were renewable, some with more restrictions on renewability, like Lebanon, which was charging money for renewing a 6 month to a year visa. And Turkey had a completely open door policy and immediately had set up. Now I think there are 23 camps. At the beginning there were about 14 camps that Turkey just almost overnight built right along the border with Syria. And one of the reasons that I think there was a stark contrast between Turkey's response in Lebanon and Jordan was, first of all, the Palestinians are a major issue in terms of the refugee policies put in place by Jordan, Lebanon, and Egypt. They were among the states that objected to becoming parties to the Refugee Convention because of the Palestinian issue. That's a conversation for another day. But it has been an underlying barrier to having a formal refugee policy in these countries for the Syrians. So Turkey had an open door policy, and because Turkey has had this amazing humanitarian agency called AFAD, which has responded in the past to incredible experience responding to earthquakes. They had a team and designs and everything just ready to go. And they built these really kind of state-of-the-art housing units. You could call them camps, but they even have washer dryers, and I mean, it's But they're on the border and quite remote, and the sort of day-to-day running of the camps was left up to the local provincial governors, and so that varied from day to day. But and during all of this time, Turkey was already discussing, negotiating for this new law that it has been that has been in the drafting phases for a very long time. Turkey's a party to the 1951 Refugee Convention that makes a major exception. It only accepts the definition of refugee to European refugees, not non-European refugees. That's sort of a holdover from the original drafting of the Refugee Convention post-World War II. Turkey's one of the few countries in the world that still retains that geographic limitation. And so it would not recognize any non-Europeans as refugees under its law, so it had to have some kind of new policy or law in order to deal with the Syrians. So this new law that finally came into place in 2014 was supposed to bring Turkey in line closer to EU policies on refugees, and that's why it has a formal temporary protection program that immediately could was triggered to cover the Syrians. Actually, the Syrians were given temporary protection even before the law came into place. But once the refugee flow started moving out to Europe, and the Europeans started putting pressure on the frontline states and giving aid contingent on containing the refugees within the region. And then because all of these states had frankly reached, maybe Turkey has not quite reached its absorption capacity, but there are other issues about the right to work that are a huge problem for Turkey because of its strong syndicates. So there was backlash that in all these states that no more Syrians could be absorbed, and hence the closing of the borders. So now Turkey has a policy of, Turkey has kind of a safe zone inside Syria, on the other side of its border, where there are people waiting to enter, thousands of people waiting, Syrians waiting to enter, and Syria has a policy of prioritizing the most urgent cases, so the wounded can still enter, particularly vulnerable groups can still enter, but the open door policy is open. Long answer to your question. Yeah.
Thank you for the presentation. Thank you for preventing me from embarrassing myself while eating while asking questions. Canada, I thought I heard this morning on the radio that in the last 4 months they got their, they're almost at their 25,000 a person capacity. About 10,000 has been done through churches, and a lot of it's done through volunteer work.
Mm-hmm.
So it seems like that is your data. You cited some Canadian statistic. Is that dated or?
No, because so Canada has a kind of interesting refugee policy. It has several categories. It doesn't just have a government. The U.S. has U.S.'s resettlement policy for refugees is government organized.
Mm-hmm.
Canada has both government and private sponsorship. Individual,
mm-hmm.
private individuals can on their own sponsor
right.
refugees,
right.
and they are, and it's often families and communities that are doing that.
Mm-hmm.
So when the figure is given 25,000. It includes, it's meant to include just the government sponsorship, and that now has so far stopped at 10,000.
Okay.
It's not clear how much the private sponsorship is because that's not recorded in the same way.
Okay.
So I need to go back and check separately, but the private sponsorships are done through both the individuals and then usually church groups
right.
working with individuals.
So
very different from the U.S.
My
yes.
understanding is in the last 4 months, something amazing has happened.
It may well be. It may
and
well
my
be.
Brother-in-law has been involved in that.
That's
I mean,
wonderful.
I'm from Montreal originally. My mother came to, both my parents came to Canada as refugees from Eastern Europe separately. So, if Canada does get up to 25,000,
mm-hmm.
Can somebody say, well, the population of this country is 10 times as much, and this
mm-hmm.
country could easily do 250,000?
Right.
Wouldn't that?
Absolutely, absolutely. And sadly, those arguments are not being made. There was a great, I just pulled it up because I thought it was so great. The Economics of Syrian Refugees in the New Yorker. And one of the points made about this, of course, if you compare what the frontline states have been, the ratio of refugees to population of the frontline host states right now and the absorptive capacity of the United States and Canada, it's kind of like the pot calling the kettle black or something like that. During the Indochinese refugee crisis, this is one of the points that was made here that was really interesting. The U.S. admitted 500,000 Vietnamese refugees in 1995, by 1995. So when we're talking about 10,000,
it's
compared to what we have already done in the past, it's a tiny, tiny number. And I suppose one of the positive things about the United States is that it did pass a temporary protection, temporary protected status for Syrians. But the problem with the way the U.S. temporary protected status program works is that you have to actually be on U.S. soil, and you have to have entered between a certain time in order to be granted that status. So that's a major disadvantage to sort of expanding the ability of Syrians to come here.
The second question is there a government in Lebanon now? I mean, a few years ago, I mean, my wife's Lebanese, and I can't ask her, she doesn't know. So you had this little war from 75 to 90, and you had Israel as a nation 2006, and the dynamics are pretty clear. My son, who was a BU student a few years ago, did a study abroad semester in AUB. But yeah, I just, don't ask me what's going on, what's happening in Lebanon in terms of.
And in fact, when we were there interviewing, it was very hard to find government representatives to talk to us about any kind of policy. Because they all said, well, we don't really have a government policy because we don't really have a government in place that's, you know, any kind of permanent government. So that's a huge issue. But the other huge issue is the relationship of Syrians and Lebanese to each other. And many of them view, so on the border, especially in the Bekaa, many of these villages have opened up their homes because
Absolutely.
These were relatives and family members and community members, and there's been so much back and forth over that border. So even closing that border has been difficult.
So Beirut to Damascus is less than Boston, Worcester?
Yeah, something like that, yeah.
Right?
It's a short drive.
Hop in the car.
And frankly, Jordan and Syria have had close ties. The working migration that's gone back and forth between the two. I mean, the Palestinians have complicated all of this.
So my understanding was, I mean, I was in Jordan in 2010. Things had already blown up in Syria, so we had to fly from Beirut to Jordan because there's no other way. But 55% of Jordan at the time was Palestinian refugees. It seems like the Jordanians who have a job are working in the Gulf. And so how do you take a country where the groundwater level is just sinking?
Right.
It's most of the people there are not Jordanian to begin with, and ask them to do a lot. And
yes, we heard this in Jordan all the time, that Jordan's the fourth most water-stressed country in the world. Doesn't have water resources for its own people.
I can't remember where I was, but there's a dip in the land. They said, well, that used to be an oasis. I pull a book out of the library, and you know, we know the next wars are about water and energy. I mean, California spends 20% of its electricity putting water over the Sierras, and how we do that is a scandal. But Saudi Arabia pumps water from 1,000 feet in some places. Like, oil is nothing, water is precious. How do we phrase this in a bigger way?
I think that's the root, that's the heart of the question. How do we frame all of these questions in a bigger way so they involve all of us? Because nothing is isolated anymore. And when we just talk about war as the root cause, how many parties are involved in the war in Syria? Everybody is engaged in that particular conflict, as almost everybody was engaged in the Iraqi conflict. And that conflict is far from being over. So, you know, part of our push in this looking at responsibility sharing was to pressure countries outside the region to actually take responsibility for the human beings with the idea that that would bring them, force them to come to the negotiating table more quickly, as has happened every time we've seen a major responsibility sharing plan for refugees. That happened in the Balkans.
Mm-hmm.
It happened in the Indo-Chinese conflict. It's happened in the conflicts in Central Africa. Whenever more countries than just the immediate countries in the region are forced to actually take the human beings, then they start talking
mm.
about peace.
Mm.
I mean, that's a pattern. It's just...
That's
a question. Christine, I think, had a question from Charlene.
I'm not a history nor a political science major, so I'm going to sound really stupid by asking this question. But can you highlight some of the major differences between the current refugee crisis with the Syrians and why it was that we're only allowing 10,000, whereas you gave the statistic about 25,000 or some whatever it was of the Indo-Chinese?
Yeah. So, well, of course, very different and complex factors. In the Indochinese situation, what brought the U.S. to accepting primarily Vietnamese, but also Laotian and Cambodian refugees, was that because of the U.S.'s war in Indochina, the countries that were receiving the bulk of the refugees were close allies with the United States, Singapore, Hong Kong, Thailand. And at some point, like in the Syrian crisis, they reached the breaking point and they started forcing boats back out to sea. And the international refugee humanitarian community was outraged by this. And the frontline states responded that, well, we are accepting these refugees on the condition that they will be resettled, but resettlement is not happening, or it's not happening at any kind of pace that's allowing us to continue to take these refugees. So then the U.S., and of course the U.S. was at that time being subjected to other pressures, ending the war, there was huge backlash internally, calling for an end to the draft. So there were political pressures that also came to bear, and the U.S. came to the table, and there was a massive, what's called a comprehensive plan of action. It was the first really international comprehensive plan of action that we have seen, but it was the first and most important precedent for the kinds of plans that have come about since then. And all of the frontline states, second states, and resettlement states all came to the table and contributed something, money, accepting refugees. The U.S. put in place something called the orderly refugee processing for primarily for Vietnamese. But at every level, there was an agreement of multiple states saying, we're going to contribute X and Y to this plan. And that helped bring about some stability in Cambodia, actually, at the end of that process, as well as later some resolution on Vietnam and Laos.
May I ask the, I'm sorry, I see your hand up, just a quick follow-up question. So the difference now is the relationship of the United States between the front line.
Yes.
The lack of relationship of the United States with the front line.
And I think no domestic pressure in the U.S. like there was during the Vietnam War. There was huge domestic pressure to end the war. And we have no such pressure to take responsibility for Syria. We had no pressure, very little pressure, to end the U.S.'s involvement in Iraq. And the U.S. took very few Iraqi refugees compared to our responsibility for that conflict.
Mm-hmm.
the question I'm about to answer is actually kind of related to, it might dig deeper, the causes of the, you know, those questions that you addressed. So my research is on like nationalist extremism and some of the Islamophobia and all these bigotries that is involved in, you know, accepting Syrian refugees. And, you know, of course I'm approaching this from a religious perspective, but I'm also interested in hearing some of the perspective from policymakers, you know, lawmakers, and what are some of the pushbacks behind the scene?
Yes. So, of course, one of the pushbacks is because it's the Middle East, and because the perception is that Syrian refugees are primarily terrorists. Now, the truth is that to get through the refugee resettlement process is one of the most difficult, complicated ways of getting to the United States. Mm-hmm. If you're a terrorist, you're never going to choose that way because you're never going to make it. Mm-hmm. And we don't really have any experiences of people who were granted refugee resettlement of being terrorists, maybe second generation, but that's people who were born here and for whatever reason turned to terrorism. But we don't have any sort of experience to suggest that that theory is correct, that refugees, resettled refugees, among them are terrorists. So, and because the way the U.S.'s priorities are given to the UNHCR, which is the agency that does the vetting for the refugee applications that get submitted to the U.S., those priorities are always the most vulnerable. So the U.S. prioritizes women, single women, women with children, women-headed households, injured. I mean, there's a short list of priorities that are given to UNHCR, and single men are not on there. So your chances are simply not very good of getting through if you have any history at all of even combat involvement, because we have bars to resettlement which are called material support to terrorism bars now since the Patriot Act. And those bars basically even prohibit people who have unwillingly somehow had to contribute to fighting forces. Or, for example, there are lots of Burmese who were forced to join one of the opposition militia groups in Burma, kidnapped, forced to cook, forced to be sex slaves or whatever. And those people have been barred because of material support, because they're considered to be contributing to the effort. So given current U.S. law, resettlement is an incredibly difficult way for someone to get here, which is why we don't reach even our 70,000 quota. So one of the ways we tried to propose to get around that is the temporary protection program with one single tweak, which is allow temporary protection to be granted through U.S. embassies or consulates in the region to allow people to get these short-term statuses to come to the United States, and then have that renewable just like we have our current temporary protected status program. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Has the United States ever had a policy like Canada where you had a dual track government?
Private sponsorship.
Private, ever?
No, the U.S. has not done private sponsorship. But the way the U.S. does resettlement, it does work with church and other NGOs to carry out the resettlement process, not the vetting process.
Right.
But once people come here, the NGOs kick in and provide benefits and help people to get integrated into communities.
Mm-hmm.
So it works that way, but we've never had private. We have, on a separate immigration track, one of the major pillars of U.S. immigration policy is family reunification. So if you do have a direct family member, you can apply for a visa, but depending on how close your relationship is, you could be waiting 10 or 15 years.
This is sort of a chicken and egg question, I guess, but you know the videos really showed global institutions completely overwhelmed.
Yeah.
But your comments pointed maybe as much to the lack of political will to respond. So is there a way of sort of parsing out?
Yes.
Where
so there's a very close connection between those two.
Sure.
Because the major organizations like the UNHCR, Their executive committee comprises about 50 states, major donor states, and they meet every year in Geneva, and they decide the priorities of the agency. And so there's a direct relationship between the political will of these major states and what and the priorities in the field, what happens to refugees. And that is the major agency. The ICRC runs a little bit differently. That's focused just on the conflict zones. That's primarily a Swiss-generated agency. So Switzerland has a lot to say with what happens there, but many states around the world donate to the ICRC as well. IOM is a little bit different because it's an intergovernmental organization. It's not a UN body, per se, and that's even more political. Other organizations that play a big role, UNICEF, again, another UN agency, some of the major non-governmental organizations like CARE International and the World Food Program, some of them are more independent. But in the end, down on the ground, they are dominated by the big players. Mm-hmm. And the big players are the UN players where states have the most to say. Mm-hmm.
Did you mention in your statistics the number of Syrian refugees that have been able to get to the United States?
Yeah. So up to now, there are about 1,500, I think we have, that have been resettled.
And how have they been able to?
So they've come through the resettlement process. There is another figure which I don't have updated, which is number of asylum seekers, Syrians who were in the United States on very other kinds of statuses and then applied for asylum when the crisis broke out. And I don't have those figures. They're much smaller than the resettlement, a handful of people. Then there are the Syrians who have been able to get temporary protection, who have not asked for asylum but have been here and then asked for this short-term status. And I think it's also perhaps 1,000 or so, not much more than that. We have some here at BU, some Syrian students
mm-hmm.
who, once they couldn't go back home, applied for temporary protected status.
Mm-hmm.
We have a couple at the law school.
So just to clarify,
yes.
Would you say all these like international organizations are independent from the actual resettlement process? So once they come in, it's up to the states. How do they help them to resettle and whatnot?
Not really. The states, individual states actually have very little say in the resettlement process. This is a federal program. And what happens is the connection is between the federal government and these non-governmental organizations, most of which operate on a national level. Not necessarily international. So here we have, for example, the U.S. Committee for Refugees. We have the International Refugee Committee, but U.S. Branch. We do the Red Cross. Here in Boston, we have a partnership between the state and there's the Governor's Office for Refugees and Immigrants. But all of these state connections work through federal grants.
Right.
So it's the federal government that gives money for resettlement and integration. And those decisions are made jointly by these organizations and the federal government.
Right.
Where are people going to go? That's where states have some voice, usually to say if, for example, a certain community, which is a magnet community, let's say in Lowell, where there's a magnet community for Cambodians, Indochinese. So Lowell may say, we already have exhausted our local resources, and there aren't enough jobs for if you bring more Syrians here. We don't have that capacity. So then that negotiation takes place, and the federal government may say, with the NGO, the national NGO, okay, well, it looks like that's not the best place. Let's look at other communities. So that's the way it works, but states don't have a lot to say because states are actually not putting much money up for this. These are federal grants for a certain period of time until refugees can work.
But again, this is also independent from the global investment.
Yes.
So I've got a question.
Yes.
I don't know what your timing's like. This, I've got a lot of more questions. We got food here now. Is it possible that we continue on over food?
Sure, yes.
And talking?
Of course.
And one of the questions, as we speak, people should just feel free to dig in. But you have here a group of folks who are related in some way to religious bodies and religious leaders. And so you're the advisor, and we've got them all together. What would you, advise these religious bodies to do in the climate we have, the political climate we have in the world today, in America today, to advance the cause of these refugees?
So, based on experience with mass refugee flows, there is only one formula that has actually helped to both relieve massive refugee crises and also move solutions forward, and that is this formula of a comprehensive plan of action. And the comprehensive plan of action doesn't necessarily look the same from crisis to crisis, but every comprehensive plan of action that has been put on the table has unlocked the solutions for that crisis. So what's required in a comprehensive plan of action is figuring out what are the various interests of the different levels of states, what are the laws in place that are already obliging those states to act in a certain way, and then put those pieces together. And that's what we try to do in our report.
So we need to get educated about that.
Absolutely. Because there, I mean, we now have over 60 years of experience with the Refugee Convention regime. And the responsibility sharing that's at the heart of this convention is the only thing that works, I can put it.
And are you finding support among churches, denominations?
A lot of positive response from NGOs, from lots of different organizations. Amnesty asked us to participate in a conference that they're trying to put together to get some of the major players in the refugee world to advance a comprehensive plan of action. The special UN special rapporteur on forced migrants has also said a comprehensive plan of action has to be put on the table. But there has to be some galvanizing for that to happen. It requires a lot of players.
That's where the church groups,
that's
religious groups become
really
important.
You've
been doing this for 22 years. Have you ever seen the political climate in America so opposed to doing the right thing?
I've been teaching it for 30 years. But
have you ever seen it this bad? And
well, you know, when I first started this work, I started with the Central American refugee crisis. I cut my teeth on that crisis. And that was an awful time. We were representing, there were 600,000 Central American refugees in the United States during the 80s, mid-80s to early 90s. And we had a very bad joke amongst us lawyers, which was that the only way you could win a Salvadoran or Guatemalan asylum claim was to have the person's death certificate. Their death certificate. You couldn't win a live claim. At that time, something like 2% of Salvadorans were getting granted asylum. 0.5% of Guatemalans were getting asylum. And they had stories far more horrific than the Russian refugees who were seeking asylum in the United States at that time, who were getting granted at over 60% grant rate. So it tells you, to answer your question, tells you the politics and how important the political climate is. We never thought at that time that there would be a resolution to the Central American crisis. And guess what galvanized things? A major lawsuit brought by the American Baptist Churches. Nationwide litigation called the ABC versus Nice. And that lawsuit forced the, at that time, the Immigration Service to produce the information that it was trying very hard to hide, which was the bias view of these cases. When that came to light, the service caved and reached a negotiated settlement, which produced the first temporary protected status program that we ever had in this country called Deferred Enforced Departure. and that actually became the codification of the TPS that we have today. Salvadorans and Guatemalans got protection, and following that, there was some other legislation called NACARA, which allowed family members to be reunified. So, and that was a terrible political climate. Lots of anger about Central Americans, just like we're seeing today. Massive detention, but not in the numbers that we have under Obama, sadly. But so I think what changes things is public awareness, public mobilizing, some of the big NGOs and church groups taking the lead, and coming together with a common platform, and demanding something really concrete that they can all agree on. And that's actually the hard part.
Right. Just to, like, to throw out some more. So I grew up in a town that has had a significant Syrian community, you know, going on three generations.
Is that Lawrence?
No, Allentown, Pennsylvania.
Oh, okay. Yeah.
And at least what's being reported in the press, I mean, I haven't lived there for a long time, so I don't really know on the ground, is that the community that's there is very divided over the question of whether or not to receive refugees, both if they, you know, sort of stigmatizing fears, but there's also some politics, and that many of them, you know, are not in support of overthrowing Assad.
Right.
And so,
yes. Well, but you don't have to take a position on that.
Well, you shouldn't have to, right?
I mean, you can. I think that there's a great way to argue the human issue without taking a stand.
Right.
And that's one of the reasons that we really focus on pre-existing legal obligations. And that also gets us out of the nasty politics in the region.
Yeah.
Turkey versus Lebanon,
yeah.
And what's going on there, Turkey versus Iran, Turkey versus Egypt, and then Russia. Yes.
So, you were avoiding politics. Let me try not to avoid it for a second.
politics.
Christians in the Middle East, they go back a long way. Christians in Lebanon, I mean, the people most despised in a way are Christians who did the Israelis' bidding and got into in the midst of slaughters and refugee camps, who now live in Israel, and they would be put to death if they were walked into Lebanon. You have other Christians who for years in Syria have been saying, you know, like Assad, he's the only guy who's into religious plurality. Turkey isn't, Saudi Arabia isn't, Israel isn't. All of US's friends don't think much of religious plurality. The Syrian thing's the only game in town. And once you order regime change, that makes it tricky. And I think, you know, this morning at the BBC, there's Al-Qaeda fighting side by side with the Saudis in Yemen. I mean, people are just so keen to get Shia out of Yemen, Shia input. Turkey and the Kurds, I mean, these people are actually helping fight ISIS. Nobody really seems to want to fight ISIS, to the point where Putin goes in there. And can it be that embarrassment might get us somewhere? I mean, if Putin, how is it that Putin is preserving religious plurality in the Middle East? You won't have it at home.
Yeah.
And the Pope and the Patriarch.
I'm not sure that's
it isn't. But it's also, you got to go back to our motives. Why we go into Iraq instead of Afghanistan, Blackwater.
Right.
Our motives go back to Caspian oil, and Putin knows that well.
Right.
And we're doing the bidding of 19th century colonialists. Why?
Yes, because Americans don't know what the U.S. is doing everywhere in the world. That's
pretty clear.
And why is that? We have I'm sorry to say, and this is not all of you guys who are lucky to be here at BU, but we have a dismal primary education system that doesn't teach our place in the world. Simply doesn't. We don't teach history. We don't even teach American history, Native American history in our schools. We don't teach another language properly, so that people feel that they're connected to the rest of the world. That's my take.
So one reference point, when I was in Lebanon, my wife's first trip back in 41 years, and the the panorama of religious backgrounds and people, even Jewish people living in Lebanon, that comes as a surprise to people. But there was this woman there in 92, and you could see she was a matriarch. And I kind of enjoyed being a social retard, just a bit sometimes. I asked her, how is it that a century or in the 1800s, Americans would go into the Middle East, build seminaries, build universities, you know, American University of Beirut, American University of Cairo, thinking that, well, once these people saw what the missionaries were doing, they'd see the Western way. And people love Western education, as when they want to become Christian necessarily. Mm-hmm. I don't think we get that. But this woman walked from Iraq to Beirut in 1933 to go to AUB. She got a model Western education. She went back to Iraq. She was an ambassador's wife through decades of Saddam, too. But she lived in Burma, all over the world. And I said, how has the perceptions of Americans changed? They were the people running around the Middle East saying, we're not like these colonial people. We're building universities and seminaries. And then a century later, after the Second World War, collapse of the English Empire, they're the more shrewd people fitting into England's shoes after oil and resources and national interests. And so how does that change? Because you have a classic American education. And so she goes on with her story, and she'll say things like, you know, 40 years ago when the CIA was here, they knew how to get things done. They would learn people's languages. They would talk to people. At the end of her summary, she was saying, yeah, and who do they listen to now? They're not getting very good information. What do they send? Drones. They don't know what's happening. They have no idea. They're like, this level of disillusionment in somebody who grew up in the 30s with a model American education was rah, 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 CIA for a long time. And to see this woman in her 90s railing to the people in the room saying, this guy, I don't know what he asked for. And I graciously took it. I mean, she made sense. It was kind of an amazing experience, and it is just amazing how we don't get to teach it. I don't know.
Other questions?
I had a question. Earlier you used the expression, I'm trying to remember, but if churches would take the lead, can you be more specific about what that means, or if you were suddenly made a bishop and you could, you know, give some direct guidance. Can you tell us what that would look like?
Well, I think having a very concrete proposal is important. To think through what are the components of a plan that would bring different groups of states with different interests together. And you know, that's really what we tried to do in our work. And churches have been very good at sort of proposing larger numbers of refugees to be admitted. They've been good at proposing family reunification. They've been good at pressuring against detention, for example, immigrants, which is a huge problem in our country. We have something like 240,000 people in immigration detention now, and there's one reason for that, and that's the private corporations that are running prisons. They're getting a huge amount of money from our public coffers in order to increase detention of immigrants, migrants, and asylum seekers. So churches have been good at doing sort of single issue advocacy, but having them come together with a multi-level proposal would be really the thing that's needed now. And sort of, you know, getting educated, thinking through all of the different pieces that need to be in place for there to be a serious responsibility sharing that would bring all these different interests of states together to the table and say, yeah, we all have a common interest in seeing something that will stabilize the region. It's not in any of the states outside the region to continue what's happening now in Turkey and Lebanon and Jordan. So, and also moving them to say, you're not going to have a negotiated solution for Syria until you deal with the bleeding of people out of that country and beyond. So that's what I would say. Not an easy answer.
How do you see the what's happening in Europe connected to Central America? Obviously the situation's different than it was 20 years ago, but it seems like we're still not wanting to recognize Central Americans as refugees because of politics.
Yes. Well, another complex historical problem. I mean, part of what's been happening in El Salvador and Guatemala and even Honduras is a direct result of U.S. policies during the dirty wars in the region. And I don't think that any politician has owned up to that. And I don't think the American public knows about this or has owned up to it. Until we get that conversation on the table, we're not going to get away from this finger-pointing of these are all illegals crossing the border. So that's one piece of it. But there has to be a renewed push for comprehensive immigration reform. This is our Central American and Latin American migration issue is bound up with other issues of short-term worker migration, labor migration, and families that are divided across the border. In the last, say, 10 years, every time there has been new legislation on immigration, it has been criminalizing, more and more criminalizing of various kinds of behaviors that make it more difficult for immigrants to work legally, for them to go back and forth as they used to do, and making their stays, their undocumented stays, criminalizing them the longer they're here, these bars, the immigration bars. So what used to be much more fluid, so you know, back in the, even up to the 80s, we had these bracero programs. Programs where the large farms in California and Texas would go down to Mexico and recruit workers for the season. And the workers could leave their families home. They came, they worked, they contributed, they paid taxes, and they could go back. We have ended that very productive relationship that was in place for forever, since we stole Mexico from half of Mexico from Mexico. but so now we have created an underclass of about 11 million people in this country who can't get status, who can't reunify with their families, and who are afraid of even ordinary interactions with police. So that's unsustainable. I mean, and that's just one small piece of this picture. Policies have been progressively counterproductive for a healthy relationship with a very close neighbor who we need, and vice versa. Okay. We've exhausted the topic.
Thank you so much. Not at all. Thank you so much.
Thank you.